What's going on, everybody? GemMintC here. Now, I used to collect key issue comics back around 2014, 2015, probably until 2016. And I got out of it when I got into statues and I got into Omnibus. I just wasn't interested in the key issues anymore. Now, every week I do a video with Comic Tom. We count down the top 10 hottest back issues of the week. What record-breaking sales are going on in the comic book market with these key issues? So I thought I'd bring Tom onto the channel and we could talk about the state of the comic book market and why prices are so high.
Maybe we can give some reasoning behind these crazy record breakers that we're seeing on a weekly basis. Glad to be here.
Yeah, we're going to explain the why and also the who. Who are these people that are coming in here spending all this money on comic books? I've always looked at the comic book market like the stock market. You have these outside forces that can cause a comic book to go up in value. I don't think there's been any bigger outside force than the MCU for the last 10 years, which started off by making the legacy characters' first appearances so much more valuable. Characters like Iron Man, like Thor, and then it trickled down to the villains. And wait a minute, Guardians of the Galaxy became successful? Now all their key issues are worth more money.
This is similar to a stock market. This is similar to precious metals. I mean, we joke, we're chatting about Golden Age comics, Silver and Bronze Age comics. However, with the types of records that are being broken on a regular basis, members of the community, as well as the mainstream who are looking to potentially invest, are finding potential in the collectible. And I think that is the key here. The fact that we are dealing with art and a medium that is enjoyed beyond the potential revenue that could be earned, but an art that is enjoyable to collect, to display, and to show off.
Yeah, you have the art aspect, and what's unique about comic books is you have the history aspect. Something like a Captain America number one that scratches the itch of superhero, but World War II memorabilia, 1940s stuff. So it is kind of like precious metals in a sense. It's also kind of like Bitcoin and cryptocurrency in a sense. And I think with investing being more popular now than ever, especially for like the younger generation, I think you're gonna see people that are into investing coming into our hobby because you can see the ROI or the return on investments in these key issue comics.
Yeah, when members are looking at investing in things like cryptocurrency, you know, the, if you would, gold 2.0 as Bitcoin has been labeled, there's a hope, you know, that this is long-term going to be the transactions of the future and the currency of what worldwide members will utilize to deal in things like lending and investing in their entirety. So the growth potential is very real. And we're even seeing that extend to the collectible in the form of NFTs, which is that exact reasoning why comics are collectible in hand art.
Yeah, so to kind of illustrate what we're talking about here, we went back to 2016. I wanted to see what key issue comics were doing around the time I stopped collecting and right now, 5 years later. So let's grab the top tier book because I want to really show you guys this trickle down effect. So an X-Men 1 from the Silver Age, 1963, first appearance of the mutants, and a CGC 9.2 in 2016. That book sold for $50,050 on the low end. It had some higher sales, but you could have picked it up for around 50K. In 2020, not even 5 years later, that book sold for $134,000.
Great example to start us out with because X-Men 1 is what we consider in the comic marketplace a blue chip comic book, a key book that traditionally does well regardless of market conditions, a near triple in value since 2016, with that record being broken near year ago, shows promise and confidence in the marketplace, but it also does something very real, a trickle-down effect to other keys, and that's what we have with Giant Size X-Men number one. Consider this. Last year, we were getting all excited about a white pager hitting $15,000 at a 9.8. And that's because back in 2016, you could secure this comic book for a low of $4,500. And where are we at today?
In April of this year, that same book, a CGC 9.8 white pager, sold for $60,000. You're talking about from $4,500 on the low end in 2016 to 60K. And there's a couple of reasons for it. Yes, X-Men 1 is a blue chip key. It was going to go up in value no matter what. But at the rate it's going now, it's definitely being impacted by outside forces. The fact that Disney has acquired the rights to the X-Men and they're going to come out with movies. So not only does X-Men 1 increasing in value cause collectors to go to the next best thing that might be more affordable, there's also speculation in Giant Size X-Men 1 because it's the first appearance of Storm, Colossus, Nightcrawler, Thunderbird, Krakoa, so many different things that could be adapted on screen, bringing new viewers and collectors into the mix. Now, another big X-Men book, everyone's favorite X-Men, Wolverine, his first full appearance in Incredible Hulk 181 has always been a blue chip. It's gone up even when Wolverine movies did bad. But now, with the hands of Kevin Feige and what Disney is going to do with the franchise has people more confident, like Tom was saying. And tell them what it did in 2016 and now in this year.
Well, back in 2016, you could secure a 9.8 white pager for a low $11,353. And we're reporting, as of 2021, a new height for a CGC 9.8 white pager of $55,900. And something to also consider as it regards to these blue chip price market shakers that are happening is that the condition of the book in 9.8 is also being looked at and critiqued to all hell. These aren't just 9.8 traditional books. These are the nicest of the 9.8, the scarcest, because not all grades are alike.
Yeah, when you're dropping $56,000 on a comic book, it better be the nicest comic book you've ever seen. It better have those deep reds, the good centering, the nice wrap so you don't see the white of the back cover showing on the front by the spine there. And what's funny, something that Tom and I have talked about on his channel is that if you can't get the first appearance of Wolverine, maybe you should go for his first miniseries or the first time he has a solo comic book. And even that book has gone crazy. Wolverine 1 from 1982, which was considered the limited series by Frank Miller, a CGC 9.8 in 2016. You could have got that on the low end at $140 and on the average around $305.
Take a look at this. Last year, this book could have been secured at a 9.8 for $600. This year, it's up past 1,000, going for 1,050. If members are curious why the marketplace in the comic industry moves the way it does, and we're seeing these gains like we've never seen before, it's because of the ramifications of the other keys, just like this one. The opportunity to buy in at a low cost is so much more reasonable when we're chatting about things that are going for under 1,000. And with comic books tripling in price in under 5 years, it opens the doors for so many more people to get involved. Take a look at Wolverine's first solo series in 1988 as Patch. We have a CGC 9.8 in 2016 going for a low $76, on average hitting just above $200. Now in 2021, a 9.8 hitting a height of $865. And we're talking about just direct market copies. We haven't even touched on the subcategory of the newsstand.
It's so crazy how it trickles down from his first full appearance to the first mini series to the first ongoing. And I remember a CGC 9.8 going for like $150 all day. And that's where this reminds me of cryptocurrency. Now, I'm not a cryptocurrency investor, I don't claim to know it all, but it feels the same to me because people are buying in at crypto when it was 30K, when it was 40K, when it was 50K. It's like everyone's looking for that right time to jump in, like it's double dutch. And I feel like that's what people are doing with the comic book market as well. Now for me, because I know comics, I feel more confident with it because I know what's going to affect these keys. I know that Disney acquiring the X-Men and Fantastic Four, they're probably in good hands and we're probably going to see some epic movies come out, which is going to bring more people into the hobby.
Yeah, we reported about Disney Plus hitting over 100 million subscribers. And I recall, I can't remember the number off the cuff, but Falcon and Winter Soldier episode one had the largest viewership. And we did the math on our show. If you were to take just a lonely 1% of that viewership and say, hey, maybe they have an inkling, an interest to engage in the comic marketplace, we were doing math that exceeded over 20,000 new potential comic members in our community. That moves the needle tremendously. And we're talking about key books, right? We're talking about first appearance of characters in teams. And that trickle down has also led to investments in things like events. You mentioned that you have a confidence in these characters because you know these types of things to be important to other collectors, which is why when we have comics like X-Men 94 come up on the list that we chat about, that it makes sense why members would look at the introduction of a famous writer or even second appearance of characters to be favorable investments in their future. Because some of these books literally take upwards of a decade to go up in value.
What's funny about X-Men 94, we used to call these books poor man versions. So like Giant Size X-Men 1 was the poor man's version of X-Men 1 and Hulk 181 because it also doubles as his second full appearance. X-Men 94 was the poor man's Giant Size X-Men 1. It's what you bought if you couldn't afford the Giant Size. But that same concept is what causes this book to skyrocket in value right along with the others.
Now, not to say that X-Men 94 hasn't seen any types of gains. I'm talking to the market potential that has been set in recent years because there's a very low census count for the grades that we're chatting about. But let's take a look at the 9.6 back in 2016, going for a height of $3,550. New records this year, setting it at $7,800. And that actually seems low to me because we had the first 9.8 sale in 11 years take place just months ago.
Yeah, back in 2010, the CGC 9.8 sold for $29,589. 11 years later, it's up 113%, selling for $63,000. So why are comic books so expensive now? Why are they rising in value? Who is coming into the market? Like I said, I think there's investment potential. So you have a lot of investors, people that are into sports cards, that are into cryptocurrency, that are into stocks. Why is it happening? We know the outside forces like movies and television shows are making them more popular and drawing more people to the characters. What do you guys think is another reason why these comic books are selling for so much more money every single time there's a new sale? And what do you think, Tom?
I'm excited to hear what the Geminites have to say about this because I can't help but think, aside from the market pool expanding, we have a level of confidence that is being showcased on a weekly basis in our members. They know this. They know the characters that they're investing in. They know it better than probably most stocks that they allocate their 401ks to. And that speaks volumes, especially in their purchasing.
As always, I appreciate you guys watching. Make sure that you're subscribed to the channel if you're not already. Hit the notification bell so you don't miss a video and come check me out over on Comic Tom 101 every week where we count down the top 10 hottest books in the comic book market. Stay minty fresh
and geek responsibly.
Peace.